professionals on the topic of developers' key to success, survival to flourishing. And I'd like to invite our session moderator, Mr. Jayesh Kariya, Partner International Tax and Regulatory, BSR and Associates, to please come on stage. Now, Mr. Jayesh Kariya is a Bachelor of Commerce and a fellow member of the Institute of Chartered Accountants. He has over 25 years of professional experience with Big Four consulting firms in India. He headed the real estate and real and construction practice at KPMG for about 4 years. He leads REITs and investment infrastructure practice in India and is a part of the Singapore REIT team. I'd also like to invite our esteemed panelists, ladies and gentlemen, please put your hands together for Mr. Adarsh Narhari, Managing Director and CEO, Mantri Primus Life Spaces, please. Mr. Adarsh Narhari pioneered luxury communities for seniors in India. A brainchild of Adarsh, Mantri Primus represents his entrepreneurial spirit and passion. Adarsh was also the pioneer in introducing the leasing model, as well as developing India's first age-in-place retirement community, an internationally accepted norm in the senior living sector. Adarsh's experience and encompasses a wide range of skills, having held and managed varied portfolios in the field of real estate development and land banking. He also serves as the current secretary for CREDAI Bengaluru. Please put your hands together for Mr. Adarsh Narhari. Moving on, our next panelist, ladies and gentlemen, can we hear some claps? I'd like you all to welcome Mr. J.C. Sharma, Vice Chairman and Managing Director, Shobha Limited. Mr. J.C. Sharma is a qualified chartered accountant and company secretary with an exhaustive career spanning across 35 years in sectors such as textiles, steel and real estate. In his 17 years, he was instrumental in leading the IPO of Shobha in 2006, an event that created history when the issue got oversubscribed by a record 126 times. It is under his leadership and guidance that the company has grown from strength to strength, employing around 3,000 people directly. He has also served as a president of CREDAI Bengaluru between 2015-17, as the chairman, FICCI subcommittee on South India real estate, and a fellow member of the Royal Institution of Chartered Surveyors. Please put your hands together for Mr. Ashish Puravankara, President, CREDAI Bengaluru and Managing Director, Puravankara Limited. Mr. Ashish Puravankara has played a pivotal role in the company's growth since he began his professional journey in the year 2000 and currently is a Managing Director of the organization. His strong entrepreneurial skills drove him to implement the best construction practices by the acquisition of new materials and focusing on technology as a means to achieve quality construction. An astute businessman, he was instrumental in developing the Provident Housing Limited, a wholly-owned subsidiary of Puravankara, in 2008 to meet the aspirations of mid-income and first-time home owners. Please put your hands together for the next panelist, Mr. Suresh Hari, Vice President, CREDAI Bengaluru and CEO, Vishal Builders and Promoters. Mr. Suresh Hari is a founder member at CREDAI Karnataka and partner at Vishal Promoters and Builders. He was a governing council member for the Skill Development Center run by State Government Labor Cess Department and Rajiv Gandhi Rural Housing Corporation at Kaushalya Sale, a Khasi government body. He also represented the construction industry at UNESCO as invited speaker for deliberations in Delhi on migrant labor. Please put your hands together for Dinesh Malkani, founder and CEO of Smarten Spaces. Mr. Dinesh Malkani is the founder and CEO of Smarten Spaces. Dinesh brings a differentiated perspective on the future evolution of organizations and industries as they adapt to the opportunities the fourth industrial revolution will bring. He leads the pioneer team responsible for shaping the blueprint to design, define, develop, and deploy the company's strategy worldwide. He's also a member of the Spartan Spaces Board. Previously, he was a president at Cisco Systems India and SAARC, responsible for the India and SAARC business, engaging with the government and companies on their digital journey. And last but not the least, ladies and gentlemen, please put your hands together for Mr. Samir Arora, CEO and Managing Director, Hux Global, General Secretary, CREA. Mr. Samir Arora is a professional with over 29 years of experience in various industry segments and markets. He has spent many years in international marketing and projects and has traveled extensively to the USA, Canada, European countries and Far East for business assignments. He established his company, Huts Global, in 2006. Mr. Arora is also the General Secretary of CREA, the leading and largest real estate association in Karnataka. He's actively involved in interacting with leading developers, CREDAI, and real estate industry bodies and governing councils for the ever-evolving policies and trade practices for the growth of the industry. Ladies and gentlemen, please put your hands together for all our panelists for this very exciting discussion that would start right now. And I'd like to request Mr. Kariya to please take over the proceedings.
Thank you very much for the nice introduction. And good afternoon to all of you. And once again, welcome to this Realty Plus event. The second session is all about the key factors from what you call it as the survival to the success or survival to the sustainable growth. And it just reminds me a small story about the survival to a success or a growth kind of. It's like a kind of a child in a human life cycle that we are a child, right? And we kind of what you call it as find it very difficult to kind of survive to stand over two legs, and we fall down again and again. But at the same time, we don't lose heart. Why? The reason is that there is a kind of a future, right? There are opportunities out there, and we are always kind of, as a human being, always kind of optimistic in the future about it. And we again rise up to the occasion, and again, possibly may fall down doing so many things. But what is important that reminds me of a story that this rise and fall is a part of our life, a part of life cycle. And one need not always think that now I'm stable, I've grown, and I cannot fall down. Because today, if you look at around over here, there is a lot of happening, a lot of digging is happening, a lot of infrastructure is happening. And if we do not kind of, I would say, take cognizance of what is surrounding us, then there are more chances that we'll fall. And if we really don't take care of it, then possibly it will not become a question of survival, but a question of our existence as well. So similarly is, I would say, the story goes, the similarly is a kind of a business story around us. In a sense that, like, take an example that if you are kind of doing multiple things and if you say that, okay, fine, I've grown manifold and I'm not going to fall down, the answer is no, because there are outside forces, and especially in the real estate sector, you are well equipped. You are well kind of wealthy, financed, everything. But the point is that the outside environment, the political environment, the social environment, the changing dynamics of the kind of the likes of the people, the products, the technology, the government regulations, the kind of the regulations around us, the corporations like companies like RERA, GST, so many things demonetized happening around us. And if we really don't take care of all these things, if we don't imbibe, and don't, I would say, kind of take cognizance of that, definitely then we are going to fall apart, kind of. This is the way that we walk on the street, and there is a kind of a road which is being dug, and we fall down, right? So that's the story about the business as well, and we have to be very careful. And I would say, the very experienced realtors over here who have gone that cycle, right, of 1980s till 2018, and this sector has seen many, the falls and the upside also. Let me just turn my, I would say, on the left-hand side, the very senior, I would say, the realtor, the professional chartered accountant, Mr. Sharma, and I think he has dealt with not from a kind of a business, but has gone to a kind of a listed company and not only doing business in India, but outside India. So, Sharma, would you just please tell us for 2 minutes about what's your kind of experience from what you call it as the survival to a growth story, every time that you survived and grew, and what are the key takeaways too that you would like to share?
Good evening, and I think thank you for setting the tone. Is it audible? Yeah. I think the way our real estate sector has been going through with, no developer with conviction can say that they have got into the growth mode. The growth mode, what we had seen, I think from 3-4 till 7-8, when it is going to come, very difficult to predict. But the messaging is quite clear. Like the law of gravitational forces, survival in a business, the survival in this cutthroat, in this highly disruptive, technology-driven environment is becoming increasingly difficult for all of us. And there are newer and newer challenges as we progress. But the beauty lies that as far as our sector is concerned, the underlying assets, whatever we are dealing with, it remains solid, it remains tangible, it remains somewhere of appreciating in nature, which keeps us giving that kind of a hope that we are here to survive. And probably vis-a-vis that story goes, the cats have probably 9 lives, we probably outlive and outbid the cats also from the survival perspective. As far as our company is concerned, we were the first company to have decided to go public, and it gave us $1 billion valuation instantly, which we were not even imagining ourselves or have understood that we can be valued that much. That happened in 2006 November, and within 2 years, or less than 2 years, 13th of October 2013, right, we got into a crisis. The crisis what you are today talking about NBFC, asset liability mismatch, sort of a thing we had gone through with, when post that global financial crisis, the money what we had taken as commercial papers and bonds, on a 2 year period, within 1 year with the put clause, right, the lenders wanted to give us the money back. And there was a story where one of my well-wisher and a friend, Dr. M.P. Soma Prasad, he calls me to find out if the police commissioner has got an information whether Mr. Sharma has committed suicide or not, sort of a thing, in 2008 late. That kind of a situation was there. And from there, that Mahesh Khetan Salarpuria, about a week back, he was telling that why not in the current environment, Shobha should talk about, as a case study to its fellow developers, how they could emerge unscathed with a positive cash flow, operational for last 13 quarters in this most turbulent times.
So what are the two right things that you did about in this whole, I would say, the life cycle, which kind of made you again more bolder and bolder, kind of?
Primarily two things.
Right.
First, the focus on the product and delivering it on a time from a customer's perspective, from the multiple stakeholders' perspective, we never gave them a chance to talk against us.
Right.
Number one. Number two, more than the profitability, the focus on the cash flows.
Okay.
Right.
Very interesting point.
That key, come what may, the operational cash flows should be sufficient enough to meet our operational commitments. And in the process, if you have lost certain opportunities, let the opportunities be lost. But the focus on the cash flows need not
be. So let me ask Suresh Hari, given that your experience kind of thing, how do you relate this current situation to the past 3 decades kind of thing, and what right things that people have done it to come out of that and gain growth manifold? So what things which will help us from here to go for the growth kingdom?
3 decades back, the scene was not what it is today.
Right.
We have not seen this level of activity or activism, we call it, or discipline that is there in the market or from the buyer side. It's
right.
not seen about 3 decades back because it's a nascent stage in the city of Bangalore particularly.
Right.
The culture of multi-dwelling was not that effective. Still, people were believing that individual housing makes a better living.
Right.
So they were running after, properties were available at a lower price. What you don't get a single bedroom unit now, you could get a piece of land then. They were believing that. So at that time, the market was different and the players were not playing as confident as they were today.
Okay.
They were not as confident as it today because it is more driven by the builders who are developing and looking at the market, creating an awareness of this dwelling. So it was a market we had created at that time. What was created at our early starters is what is driving the total dynamics today in the city. Because the city, what has seen today is the wonderful aspect of developers' community in Bangalore particularly. I should say the sensible approach, not overdoing their development, and being relevant to what is presently required is what driving today. So that sustainability is not an angle. If you want one, if a different type of management perspective to be looked into, if you want to write a theory of positivity, I think developers are an example for that. Because I fully agree with you. Yes, because Sharmaji spoke really well about it. It's something, you know, it's not a joke of sort. We hear these type of things very often, and whenever market crashes, because, see, we are the one who handle not just one element. It's thousands of factors we have to handle. It's human driven, and it is still not based on automated systems.
So what are my specific question to you? What are the two things that I think the developers continue to do it, which made them not only to survive, but to grow also?
Especially developers in this part of the world here,
right.
And what I say is, they are sensible on pricing, sensible on the product mix, and sensible on how they choose their customers.
Okay, yeah. Okay, great. Great point. So let me turn to Ashish. Ashish, you have been kind of been growing, not only in the southern market, but I think you have reached to the other parts of India also, and it's not easy because it is said that the real estate is a kind of what you call a state-level subject. And whenever you go outside the subject, the challenges, nuances are different. So how did you manage the growth trajectory and the growth potential? And how do you see that this phase will grow manifold kind of? So what are the three things that you did consistently that helped you to kind of grow?
Firstly, I strongly believe that, I mean, in terms of demand for real estate housing across the country is very strong. One thing that helped us succeed to go, so we were actually a Bombay-based company. We moved to Bangalore in 85, I think. Since then, we've gotten into 8 cities, 4 states now. I think the mantra for success was a brand. So even today, so when we enter new markets, like for example, we had a launch in Pune about 2 years ago. We sold almost 60% of our stock in the first 3 quarters. And I think that is because of the brand. One of the things, my suggestion is people don't realize the importance that you need to invest in your brand. You need to invest in your product. And once you establish that brand, I think it's fairly easy to grow across markets, right? That is one. Secondly, I would say is also focus on execution. Thirdly, I think the model. So what we have done is every new market, every new city that we have entered into, we have created a mini Puravankara there. For example, so we have locals who are running that office. They understand the local sentiment. They understand the local nuances in terms of clearances, sanctions, etc. They speak the local language. Unlike some national players who try to establish themselves across the country, but everything was still being controlled in a hub and spoke model from Delhi or wherever they were. So here we broke that myth. We said, no, let's set up mini offices, have business heads. So each city is a profit center in itself. And I think that model has worked well. Of course, a great team in place as well. So I would say mainly is the brand.
Absolutely. I think a very well point made that brand people, I think, forget all the time. And then when it comes to a brand, people just talk about it, okay, it has to be there on the wall, but it doesn't get created on the wall. It just creates from your kind of the values, the kind of the integrity, the kind of the process that you have, and the consistent, I would say, that quality that you deliver, that itself creates a brand. So let me turn on a kind of execution point, and we have my friend architect over here, and he has, I think, worked with a lot of developers. Now, what is your kind of view on a brand when it comes to kind of, from an architectural point of view, do you see that by creating a kind of a monument will create a brand, or kind of creating the livable product will make it a brand, or what is in your view?
Sorry, Jayesh, first, I'm not an architect.
Sorry. Okay.
So I don't think I'm intelligent enough to be one, but obviously design is core to any business.
Right.
So we are in the senior care and senior living business.
Okay.
So the evolution of the brand, just like Ashish pointed out, is more in the attention to detail of the product, how aesthetic it is, how usable it is.
Right.
And in a real estate developer terms, you need to be mindful, especially in the context of RERA, about how much space you're building that your customer cannot use. Right. If you're going to have unnecessarily wide lobbies, or you're going to have grand foyers, they are getting loaded into your carpet area. Right.
Right.
So there's a fine balance. You can't have a train bogey to get into. At the same time, you can't have a very lavish space which is not usable.
Right.
So I would say that that's where developers need to find their balance.
Okay, very interesting. Now let me turn from here. When you talk about the brand, and we all talk about that brand and technology goes hand in hand, in a sense that you use either outdoor media, indoor media, or physical media, and then you create a kind of a brand, right? But in today's time, I think those, I would say the physical, I would say things are still in existence. It's not, I'm not going to say that these are all disappearing, as Amit did mention that beyond a point, we are all human beings. We need personal touch, we need personal attention. And that also plays a very important role. But let me turn to Dinesh about the role of a technology, not from a branding perspective, but in the entire eco-cycle of real estate. How do you see the role of IT and the technology? And is that the kind of, what do you call it, the one of the important ingredient for the success and the sustainable growth for a real estate developer?
Okay,
sorry,
thank you.
Question.
Yeah, no, absolutely. So let me just kind of make one statement, right, that there's never been a better time to adopt technology in the real estate business. We tried to do it 4 or 5 years ago, and I've been on this journey for a long time. The problem was the technology was not ready. The problem was it was expensive, it was hard to deploy. The user base itself didn't think it was important.
Okay.
But today times have changed.
Right.
The tenant, the actual consumer of the space, is demanding a very different experience.
Right.
The way that construction is done itself, Ashish talked about operational excellence, right? I can tell you that there's a huge difference between a site that's going to get built in the future that is heavily designed through technology, heavily looked at, you know, what are the basically best practices available through technology, and then stood up using technology. I think that's the direction where developers are going to move. And if you think about it, whether it was co-working that came in and started to disrupt the commercial market, or I'm a big believer of co-living, by the way. I think that is going to create a lot of buzz in the market, but the acceptability will be very high. As a real estate company, you have to start today understanding data, you have to understand technology, and you have to start looking at ways on applying it across the value chain, right from construction all the way to monetization. For the ones that take it on the front foot, I think they're going to benefit significantly. But please don't do technology just for technology's sake. Identify your business goals. And we are working with real estate companies in Singapore, India, US, London. And I think across the board, everybody agrees that it's time to move.
Yeah, it reminds me of a one video clip on the technology side, which was very heavily used. And again, it reminds me from the city. So it was like it recognizes your voice. So switch on the lights, switch on the gizzards, switch on this, switch on that. So that all these instruments recognize all these voice kind of thing. And then he one day stepped out, and then he had some tooth problem, and he went to the doctor, and then he was kind of treated. By the time he came back home, and he was not able to open his mouth. So open the door. But the point is that the machine was not recognizing, and it started kind of heavy rainfall, and that poor fellow had to kind of stay on the street kind of. So one need to also be cognizant of the fact that technology is very, very important, but at the same time, you have to be mindful of the use of the technology, because you can't just overuse anything, which will not only kill your product, but also kind of kill yourself kind of. So let me come back to Samir on the question of what do you call it, growth, right? We have all survived, and I would say the developers community, I compare them, all of them, as Narendra Modi with a chest of 56 of size, right? And they have always survived with all kind of problems, all kind of tsunamis that happened. Demonetization was one of the biggest tsunami that happened in the real estate segment. But they all survived. They are going to grow from here. That's very clear. So people always forget about what you call it as the, you always own your own cocoon, that this is what I want to sell. That's not the time. But now you have to kind of understand what the customer requires. So Samir, just a question to you, that if you were to design or survive and design a growth trajectory, how much role that a customer, not only a customer in a sense your buyers, but the customer in a sense your channel partners, your vendors, your kind of has to kind of contribute, and how much that attention that you should pay to design your growth strategy?
Thanks, Jayesh. The realtors community
and the Realtor is actually a patented word for the channel partners, for the
right.
people who market it
right.
really. On their behalf, I would just say, I think we've seen equivalent examples, as you see in developers and more, of those 56 inches chesters as you talk about.
Right.
You know, and I think somebody said it right. We are here not to survive. We are here to thrive. We are here to nourish and flourish with passion and compassion, a little humor, and with our own story. And I think the Realtors have proved it over the last 2 years consistently. So you're talking only of tsunami. I think with tsunami, with earthquake, and with the volcano in terms of RERA, demonetization, and GST, please understand the larger developers still had the funds and the cash flows to manage it for a time. Some of the Realtors that you're talking about had a hand-to-hand business, hand-to-mouth business, and were quite shaken up with all these changes that came by. And they've only grown from pillar to post. I have a gentleman sitting here, Mr. Ravi Kant from Elegance Enterprises, and I would not like to go into 30-year-old success stories, but 2-year-old success stories from the point of demonetization till today. In a project of Jindal City, he and his company with about 25 people have sold 250 apartments in the same phase. They've sold over 2 lakh square feet in a reliable project. And people like that and more success stories in Confederation of Real Estate Associates, CREA, is what we've been extremely proud of. So what you're exactly talking, I will use 2 words, disruption and organize. So if you hear that statement very often in and around the real estate circles, saying the big will grow, the small will vanish. And I think it's crap. Whether it's developers, whether it's realtors, or whether it's vendors associated with the real estate industry, the organized will grow, the unorganized will vanish. And I think that's the key to it. So organized will include digital, organized will include technology, organized will include all the things, including RERA and everything that you talk about. Second is, come at the hour, come at the man. So disruption is going to be the norm of the day. And with disruption, with the new evolutions, you will see amazing thing. I think the pace India will catch up with the West in terms of real estate principles is going to be absolutely mind-boggling from here on.
Thank you very much. Very, very interesting point that you made, and I agree. I had a question, but I would defer that question because there has been a lot has been talked about that consolidation is the kind of the reality kind of. So therefore, I will just hold back on that question. That's also very important and create a debate. Let me just ask a question to Sharmaji kind of because he has kind of seen the world on both the sides, India and outside India as well. Now, what do you see, sir, Sharmaji, that what are the key pillars of the growth? Survival, we will manage, but what are the key pillars of the growth? Is it the land bank is the growth or the availability of the land? Or is it, Ashish talked about, that execution is very important? Or is it the right, as Mr. Hari talked about, the product kind of thing? So in your mind, what is it that important? Is it that Sameer talked about the organization kind of thing? I may ask and say, is it that kind of what you call it as the governance is important, or professionals like us being on board, or like your being on the board, is the kind of a factor for the success and the growth? So what are your kind of thoughts?
See, my belief is the land still will remain for the real estate developers. One of the key differentiating and the important factor to get himself differentiated. And it cannot be done away with. And all the more in the Indian context, where the availability of the land or the opportunity is not uniformly available, like you can buy steel or cement or any other product, or you can even hire some people as well.
Right.
So that makes it a bit differentiated. But at the same time, all said and done, that the business of land banking or only asking the premium on the land banking and ignoring all the factors just now you have enumerated, it will not carry the day. So the land bankers, whosoever who they are today, some of them are developers, some of them are otherwise purely developers, they have lost that kind of leverage because of the NPV or the carrying cost of such a land vis-a-vis the return what they are getting. But it will still be, if you have 4 to 5 years of an inventory, and accordingly you keep the land in your balance sheet,
right,
it will work to your advantage.
Okay, okay. So you're saying that land is equally important, but more important is the kind of, as Ashish rightly said, that your execution, your branding, your strategies, right selection of the project, right selection of the product. I think the whole organization and the planning will make a lot of difference because the land would be available. So let me just come back on the same question to Ashish, that obviously you have been kind of talking about kind of doing the development in the 8 cities and the 4 states. Obviously, you won't start with buying the land on your books of account, right? So therefore, what is it that kind of help you to get access to the land and you are able to kind of make your mark in those kind of markets?
I'll again go back to brand. So to
right.
be very honest, so the reason we got into Pune was not because we identified Pune as a market. We were approached by landlords and developers from Pune inviting us to do a joint development with them. So
okay.
that was our first move into Pune.
Okay.
Right? So it was the brand that got us that inquiry, and that's why we got in.
So let me ask a question. I think you have been very humble in using the brand. So how did you build the brand? Let me ask this question. That has been a kind of a success mantra of your kind of a growth and is going to grow manifold. What are the ingredients that you would like to kind of narrate about the brand? How did you build the brand and what makes the brand? I have Jaideep over here, but I think
there are multiple factors.
I think
to start with, I think the very first thing is the dealing with the customer.
I think
in terms of transparency, I think in terms of focus and execution, like Sharmaji said, delivering that product on time. I think these are the two key factors. There are sub-supporting factors help you deliver that thing on time. So in terms of technology, we were one of the first adopters of, as an example, aluminium formwork way back in 2000.
Okay.
We were one of the first adopters of precast in residential construction way back, I would say, about 6 years ago, 7 years ago. We have delivered about 3 million square feet, 3,000 apartments 2 years ago in precast.
Right.
So I think innovation, constantly looking at how to adapt technology to be able to deliver a quality product on time. Your dealings with your customer in terms of transparency, every project has issues. Fortunately, unfortunately, in this country, in terms of land records, revenue records, there are always some of the other issues. But in terms of constant, clear, honest communication with the buyers, as long as you stand behind it. You know, I'll give you a small example. You know, I was at site about a month ago, and there were some customers who had come to inspect, and the project is still under construction. And, you know, they seemed thrilled, and I said, why did you choose Apurvanka? And they said, because they're a brand. That was the first thing. Second reason they gave why they bought into that project was they said, okay, we like the location. Third, they said, because of Purvankara, we know it will be delivered. Okay, there may be a delay here and there, but you will deliver the product and you stand behind the title, right? So I think ensuring that you stand behind your product and so that customer, how the experience from the time he inquires the very first time till you hand over the key, the minute you can better that experience and constantly innovate on bettering that experience, I think elevates your brand. And people who don't focus on that, I think tend to lose out in building that brand.
I think it's a fantastic point that you're making. It's not kind of what we call it as living the brand, creating the brand, but it's a living the brand. So what we call it, that don't create the values, leave the values. The moment you leave the values, I think the value gets, I would say, manifold kind of grow. Let me just turn to Hari and ask a question because you've seen the kind of, I would say, the so many decades. And again, coming back to Samir's, do you think that the mom and pop or a proprietary business model would not be able to grow kind of, or is it that you need to again come back to an organized corporate, not in a sense private limited company, but behave like a corporate kind of, or behave like an industrious. Is that the kind of mantra for the growth?
Whether you like or not, that's the only way out. Because
okay.
The old models will not survive. But I'm not telling mom and pop culture will not be there.
Right.
It will exist, coexist. Large conglomerate taking shape in their own way. See, this is the time when either mergers and acquisitions are going to happen.
Right.
Let us be frank about it. Large players are going to have a field day. Definitely, that is going to be the talk.
Right.
But small players do have a space here because there is a niche market there also. And they know how to survive in that market. Let us not foregone conclusion that these Kirana traders are off. No.
Right.
They have their packet and they know how to survive that market. And it will continue because this is something, you know, in real estate, we are forgetting roti, kapra, makan, all the three elements. Roti, without that, somehow you will get food and eat. Kapra, you don't have, you can wear a leaf and go. But house is something you need to buy. You have no choice. The world, you know, travelers, if you take the record of travelers, why do we go, we see monuments and buildings, who are they? The developers, we are the developers. You call them the anytime, we are the one who create wealth creators. So wealth creators have a space always, they know how to create wealth.
Okay, one interesting point that you make, and that always bothers me kind of thing, anyone the kind of the changes that is happening around us, the kind of the dynamics is changing, the likings are changing, the millennials are coming into existence, the IT is playing its role. So let me ask a question to Samir from a, what you call it, the realtor's point of view. Do you think that the next phase of growth, we have been seeing co-works and WeWork kind of thing, do you think that the people will not own the properties? People will say that, forget it, I don't want a house, right? I'm better off buying a house rather than buying a house, renting a house because I'm fungible. I can move from one city to the other because I and my spending, like credit card, everything I'm spending, my saving ratios in India is also going down. So does that kind of, do you think that that is changing the whole, I would say, the landscape for the buyers and the real developers as well?
I think it's a fabulous question that has emerged, but give me about 15 seconds extra for a joke.
Sure.
So this is what my younger son told me 4 days back, and this is your generation next. He told me, Dad, neither am I going to marry, nor will I allow my children to marry. So I think that's where the next generation is headed to, really. My son.
Of course, the son Ashish, will not allow him to marry.
I'll respond to that later. However, what I'm leading to it, I think you're very right. Today, a youngster, especially in the IT industry, educated youngster, has a much larger wallet with money to spend. And we were beginning to believe that they are buying houses early. You know, there was that stage.
Right.
They've come to the next stage.
So that's the disruption I'm talking
Absolutely.
About. You mentioned about
so the next disruption is, why should I pay EMIs for a lifetime into a fixed asset? I want to lead my life. You know, based on that concept, all the one bedrooms and the studios and everything has started. I don't know if you're already noticing in Bangalore, but my perception with the direct dealing with the clients is, I think there's going to be an oversupply on that very, very quick, even in a city like Bangalore. The proof of the pudding lies in the fact, you look at California, you look at US, you look at the lifestyles around, people buy houses. Markets will still grow. Fundamentals will come back. And the family values in India are going nowhere. The youngster from 22, 23 till 30, 32 remains a youngster, gets married, comes back and becomes the Indian, irrespective of where he lives. So I personally feel, I think some of the gentlemen, especially Ashish sir and Sharmaji had said this, I think the markets will continue. It's just a tough phase. It's just a tough phase. And the segmentation of the market in all of these segments will grow. We will have to innovate a little bit in terms of what is required at that point of time for all of these people, and it will still continue.
Good. Let me ask an interesting question down on the residential that we talked about. We all talk about IT is changing, and artificial intelligence also going to change. So, Dinesh, what do you see that this commercial spaces, we talked about residential, right? Commercial spaces. Do you think that these developers, I think, will lose the business on the commercial space because now you can work from anywhere in the world, right? So do you think that that product will kind of die?
No,
these, I would say, the developers are smart enough to kind of take the challenge and convert that into an opportunity.
So last year, I went to New York.
Right.
And okay. There's a show called Nippon.
Okay.
And everybody there was talking about WeWork.
Right.
WeWork has come and they're disrupting the commercial space.
Right.
This year, I went back to Nippon.
Okay. We are on video. So please
yeah, no problem.
Be careful about WeWork and
so
co-work and all.
You know, there were 5 times the number of people that came to attend
right.
that show. And nobody was talking about brands.
Right.
What everybody was talking about, the tenant. The tenant itself, the tenants themselves started putting pressure on the developer saying, I'm going to take a certain percentage as fixed allocated seats from you, which I've been doing for many years. Maybe I don't sign a 10-year lease, I'd sign a 5-year lease. Because in a digital world, they don't know what their headcount is going to be 3 years
right.
down the road,
yep.
right? But I also want options where at least 15 to 20% of my workforce can work in flexible spaces.
Right.
Now, if you as a developer can provide me the full stack where I say 5,000 employees fixed, 2,500 in a managed space or satellite offices, and 2,500 in a flexible, then that developer is the winner. Because if they have the ability to do that, then from a security standpoint, consistency standpoint, brand standpoint,
right.
it works out much better for the tenants.
Okay.
Now that move, I can tell you, has started at a much faster pace than what many companies around the world had anticipated. In India also, we can see a little bit of that movement coming in. I think next year, same time, the story will be very different. It would have actually picked up quite a lot.
Okay, so let others say something and have a different question to others also.
So I want to just
from
take
a growth perspective.
That point. See, when Amazon came to India, when Flipkart came, right, everybody said malls will shut down. Nobody's going to buy in a mall, right? So and that is not even too far in the past that we don't know what we're talking about. So the retail density, the online trading density as a percentage of retail in India is 2%, okay? And the high in US, it's 6%. So, and the highest in the world is in tier 3 or tier 4 cities in China, which is 17%. So all the naysayers who said malls, nobody will go, nobody's going to buy, business is going to slow down, has in fact seen a growth. So if you see India, if you see United States, if you see China, malls have grown. So I don't believe it's going to be any different either for residential, either for commercial, or any other asset class. The way we deliver to the customer is going to undergo some change. If residential inventory is 50,000 units a year today, I don't see that changing. If 50,000 units is selling, maybe 20,000 may go to co-working, something may go to senior living, something may go to co-housing, but the overall stock will improve, and possibly the residential yields will start to go up instead of the capital appreciation.
Very interesting point. I'll just stay on that. Okay. Now, do you think that if people or the realtors have to grow from here to the next phase, or the next 5 years kind of thing, do you think that the traditional residential houses will be the kind of the business model or the alternate asset class where people talked about co-work, senior citizen, education housing kind of, so those kind of products will kind of help to grow, or foster the growth? So what do you say about it?
So
and how do you see that?
The beauty about India is there's a market for everything.
Okay.
If you open a newspaper or you go through a website, you know that this is a country where there's a market for everything. The way I see it is that there's going to be space, there's going to be developments which are more integrated again, like we heard earlier,
right.
in terms of larger developments having different options available.
Right.
So there'll be a component of work, there'll be a component of stay, there'll be long-term rental, short-term rental, old people living, young people living, student housing. So I see that that's the way that areas are going to evolve and projects are going to evolve.
But should the developer, like taking example, Ashish,
yeah.
should get into all those 5-10 things? Would you, as an advisor, tell Ashish that, okay, no, Ashish,
I think
if you want to grow
it,
10 times or 5 times, then I think you should have this asset class. Would you dare to, or would you kind of like to do that to Ashish?
Yes, I think everybody will need to look at these asset classes at some point in time to keep those NPVs and IRRs in check.
Okay, so let me just hear Ashish about, what are your thoughts, Ashish, on that?
So I think India as a market, I think, is maturing. Right. So earlier it was that one standard residential building which was used for senior living, which was used for regular living, which was used for co-living, which was used for student housing. As the market matures, and I think to be competitive, people will have to start providing specialized living spaces for the end user, right? Which would mean diversifying and specializing into student housing, into co-living, into general ownership into senior living. Now, in terms of integrated townships, I think they will start getting a flavor, so you can actually segregate, because each use has its specific requirements. Like a senior living example, so you know, in terms of the basic design of the units, co-living. So recently, in fact, we've done a study of co-living spaces in London and New York. The layouts are completely different. You know, so you have more community spaces and you have lesser spaces inside. It's this whole Indian mentality that, you know, you want to brag on the size of apartment that you buy. I own a 3,000 square foot apartment. But inside that 3,000 square foot apartment, your kid is doing tuition in one end, somebody else is doing handicrafts in some other end, some lady is doing some kitty car. So today what we're seeing is, what is the space required for one to live efficiently? And we are providing more community spaces. So, you know, like in our projects now, we are providing a special space in the clubhouse for students, for children to get tuitions. Why should that kid be sitting in a living room, the father or mother is sitting and watching TV on mute, and we are occupying that space? Just provide that. So I think specialized services, specialized requirements will be the need, is the need of the hour, and we'll see more specialization come into each one of those verticals going forward.
A very interesting point that you made. Yes, it's like what do you need? You need only, what do you call it, as a just chafe it, right? So if that is enough, rest is all, if the world is with you, then you need just a small space. But if you have a larger space to kind of coordinate, cooperate, and play together, then I think that makes your life more fulfilling. Let me just come back to Mr. Sharma on the cash flow, which is a kind of what you call as the lifeline, the king, right? And that's very kind of very hard to all the developers, right? So, sir, what is your view? I have two questions over here. How do you kind of manage your cash? How do you attract cash? I'll come back to Ashish on attracting cash from the private equity players. How did he manage very well? But I'll come to you. But listing, another my question, the first is a cash flow management. Maybe you would like to share your thoughts. But listing, in this year, 2018, we saw about 15 developers kind of just very gung-ho about going for listing. And we didn't see, I think, much of the listing on that side. So my question to you is that, is the listing the kind of a path for the growth trajectory, or that one need to be kind of very thoughtful and careful going for listing? So two questions on cash flow and listing.
See, as far as the listing is concerned, we have not two questions in our mind. If your organization is ready from a perspective of compliance point of view, management point of view, delivery point of view, the brand what Ashish has been talking about kind of a thing, there is no better method to raise capital through a listing process. Because in any case, we have to submit our data to multiple authorities. In RERA, we have to be giving all possible informations to the government authorities. While taking the bank loan, we have to give all possible information to the authorities for buying the land and getting the due diligence. In any case, you are exposed to the external world. Via listing, you can capitalize because you are already exposed, making it a virtue out of the necessity what you are going through, and raise capital and still control the company. In India, well-run managed companies, they are controlling their businesses like Tata's or Aditya Birla Group with roughly 30-35% of the holdings. So one-third of the holding, 100% of the ownership, and easy availability, listing, no-brainer.
So you're saying that listing is something, a right strategy, but the point is that you have to be kind of prepared for that. It's good to see an Aishwarya Rai in a function rather than getting Aishwarya Rai in your house.
It is like this. There is no other way out. Today, okay. Post demonetization, post GST, post RERA, post whatever.
Okay, hold on. You're saying that listing is the only way out?
I'm not saying this. What I'm trying to say, in any case, if you are in the business, you are doing the right thing. If you are delivering the product, you are doing the right thing. You are working in an environment where you will continuously need the capital, and the listing will ensure that you can raise the right kind of a capital at the best possible rates.
It's a very onerous responsibility to my mind. It's like, okay, getting an Aishwarya Rai in your home house, then okay, fine. One has to be able to maintain the Aishwarya. At the same time, there will be a crowd outside who would like to look at the Aishwarya. So you have to manage both the things. And Ashish said, you have a different.
I'm a little divided on that.
Okay.
I think, yes, of course, being a listed company gives you access to capital. But I think one needs to also understand what business we are in. For example, a residential-focused business. Unfortunately, our projects take 4 to 5 years to be developed. We sit on extensive land banks, which is very difficult to value. In the euphoria, everyone got great value. But today, if you speak to investors, you speak to analysts, they are still scratching their heads and they're still recovering. While various developers claimed 100 million square foot, 5,000 acres, 10,000, how much is that really yours? How much litigation is it? Can it be developed? Can it not be developed? I'm an investor. I'm going to hold your stock for 2 years and I'm going to exit. How much of this 5,000 acres are you going to deliver or execute in the 2 years? How much profit will that generate? How much dividend will you give it, give to me? So in the euphoria, yes, everyone got great. I'm a little divided to say that residential focused players, you're going to see a big swing in terms of valuations. So when you want to hit the capital market to get access to that capital, as a promoter, you will definitely believe your valuation is 1/5. And unless there's a gun on your head, you won't dilute at that value. On the other hand, if you are an annuity business, so you're in the commercial business, there is visibility of annual cash flows. I think there's analysts and investors it'll be easier for them to value you. I think it'll be a fair value. And that can be a constant access to multiply a commercial business, right? So I'm a little divided in terms of
a residential player
being listed vis-a-vis a commercial player being listed.
So let me ask you a question, Ashish. How did you get extra cash from the private equity players? And what has been your kind of USP to get the money from the private equity players as opposed to the listing?
So we were one of the first guys when FDI in real estate opened up way back in 2005.
Right.
I think ours was the first or second transaction that happened, and we had a joint venture with Keppel Land of Singapore. I think the key factors there really were, while Keppel did go across the country and try to find partners, the reason that they told us they chose us is our transparency and I think our focus on execution and technology. So these were the three reasons that they chose us.
Great. So you were following the RERA principle, that be transparent, be kind of honest, that's the only way. Okay,
but
great.
I should give credit. I think most, the city that we're sitting in, I would say most developers here, if you compare them with the rest of the country,
right.
I think the focus from day one, and it's not today and it's not RERA, I think from day one the focus has been on execution, the focus has been on product, the focus has been on transparency.
Great. So I think you talked about
maybe the groundwater here.
Yes, absolutely, absolutely. So my last question I think you addressed, but let me just ask the same question to everyone. Please tell the two golden rules, which will kind of remain as a gold, piece of gold, right, for your lifetime, right? That's what we have been taught.
Be transparent and be conscious of what you're doing.
Transparent and conscious. Sir, Sharmaji.
Remain customer focused as well as cash flow focused.
Cash flow and customer, two C's of the life. Others?
Put yourself in the shoes of the customer. If he's smiling, you're smiling.
Okay, very great. Would you like to add something, Ashish, to what you said?
I would say innovation, very, very important because we are in a disruptive environment right now.
Okay.
So being very agile and keeping your ear to the ground to see how buying behavior, maybe co-living or whatever, is how buying behavior is changing, patterns are changing. So I would say innovation would be one addition that I would
do. Okay, innovation. Samir, 2 points.
Service and experience is one that we deliver to the customer.
Okay.
So it will be customer-centric.
Again, customer.
And innovation.
Innovation.
Absolutely.
Dinesh.
So, change is constant.
Okay.
And I think you have to be ready to... especially in a digital world, I think the pace of change is going to increase. But change will always remain constant. And it kind of depends how you basically look at that change and change yourself to be able to...
Okay. So great. I think we had great insights. The only one word which I was very kind of keen to hear, that if you have to be realtors, right, you have to have a jigra, jigger. right? You have to be an entrepreneur. You have to be bold enough. That's, I think, very important. And I've seen, I have experienced the stories of the developers who had a pocket, who did not have 100 rupees in his pocket, but he did a deal of 100 crores because he was knowing that how he's going to get that 100 crores. So that's most important. And then you have to be stand tall enough kind of to deal with all this. So thank you very much for this great insights. And I don't think I have any time for questions, but unless the Realty Plus allow us, then I think we can take one or two questions.
Unfortunately, we do not have time for questions, but you know, all of our eminent panelists, they're please. All here, you know, for the rest of the afternoon and the evening, so please make your way towards them, and you know, you may feel free to ask any questions. So could we give a huge round of applause to our panelists? This was a really, really interesting and piquing discussion. And please do not step off the stage. We have a little something for you. I'd like
thank
to invite Mr. Pratik Mathur of Prism RMC and Mr. N.A. Dayananda from
sir,
Navmi Builders and Developers to please present a small token
yes,
of our appreciation to our panelists today. Everybody, could we have a huge round of applause, ladies and gentlemen, for this really esteemed panelists and that absolutely interesting conversation. Right, thank you so much.